I thought I'd leave that in because it was quite funny. That was me realising I was actually recording myself on camera. Hi guys, it's Mike here, One Go Short Play. I'm talking a bit quietly because it's pre-7 in the morning. That's one of those mornings where I'm up bright and early for work. And I'm actually up bright and early because we've got a delivery due anytime from 7. And it's my duty to deal with it, basically, while Joe and Lucas are asleep upstairs. Now, first of all, really sorry about the massive delay in videos. Christmas, New Year, babies, stuff, family, you know how it is. We were hoping to stay at home this New Year and just have a quiet one. It didn't end up that way. We did have a quiet one, but some people weren't able to get here and it got complicated, and we ended up going up north twice to see family, which is alright. It's just, it was a bit more exhausting than we thought it was, and anyway, it was exhausting, and we ended up getting one day to ourselves, and that was the day before I went back to work. And at work, it's kind of cool because, as I was saying to you in an earlier video, I had the responsibilities lowered because it was a new job. I didn't have to think much about what I was doing. Well, they're onto me, and they know I can do more than I was doing. So they've moved me into the marketing department, essentially, where I'm doing much cooler stuff with my skills. And a bit of it's code, and a bit of it's artwork, and it's cooler. And that's good in a way, but it means that I'm not able to YouTube as I was in those weeks before Christmas, where I was getting quite prolific. I'm still able to. I've just got to kind of find my feet in my new departments and see how things go. And obviously, that's my priority. Anyway, to the point. I'm going to try not to cut this. You might notice I'm in a different location, a different format. The reason for that is I don't have the time. I usually film in the office on the iPhone. And then I spend ages just cutting out all the M's, which I do ramble, so I cut all that out. And I usually cut down a good 20-minute video down to 10 minutes, and I don't have the time to do that, so I'm hoping I can get more to the point here. Basically, what's happening here is I'm in the house. I've been up to the office to pick something up that I wanted to show you, and we'll get to that in a minute. But I'm in the house this morning, which is why I'm being quiet, because Joe's there. And basically, see, this is what happens. I forget what I was talking about. I just lose my train of thought, and then I've got to cut that out. I'm not going to today. I'm going to just put this up. it's all a bit different. And I'm recording on my laptop's camera. I usually record on my iPhone, but that iPhone is now on its last leg, so much so that one of the things I'm waiting for to be delivered today, which probably won't come before I get to work, is a new phone. Mine was an iPhone 4S. It's like 7 years old or something now. It's great that it's lasted that long, and it's had a few repairs, but that's a tangent that we're not going down. So I'm just trying this on the laptop to see if it works, and it seems to be so far. That little bit of early video at the beginning was the first video of me realising I was recording this, and I thought the look on my face was quite funny, so I thought I'd keep it. Now, yes, before Christmas, MameMeister did a video about piracy memories of piracy, the wonders of piracy when you were a young person, or in my case, a child. Him and a friend of his were talking about mainly the Spectrum and recording tape to tape and the Amiga. Now, they were my two computers as a kid, so all the way through that video, I was commenting away on the video going, oh yeah, I remember this and then that, but my perspective, it was a little bit different because I think I was about 10 years younger, maybe a little bit less. So, different perspective, and a lot of it was down to looking back, disposable income. And I thought I'd talk about my memories of it. Now, I'll be brief because I know this video is going for ages, and I want to show you something that relates to this memory in particular that I found. But basically, the ZX Spectrum days, I was 9 when I got a Spectrum. I didn't know about piracy. All the games I got were pretty much bought for me. Mostly at first Christmas, the likes of Donkey Kong, Alien Destroyer, No Mummy, a lot of stuff came with it. Ghosts and Goblins, they got them in Paperboy, and a few other games like that, that became synonymous with the Spectrum for me. And later on, Target Renegade, which is just the best Spectrum game if you're into brawlers, and I am into brawlers. Good ones. Now, I didn't do much pirating on that, but I did have some friends down the road whose brother was 10 years older than me, and he had loads of cassette tapes with games on them, like C90s full of games. And you'd have to kind of sift through the 90s to see what was on it, and a lot of them didn't work, and the tapes were a bit crummy and old and wrecked. And I remember thinking, not knowing that this was piracy, but knowing that they weren't official, like they'd been copied, not really knowing the legalities of this sort of thing, because, you know, nine. I could just play the games, and that was great. And I'd borrow games off them and play them on tapes. And what struck me was that a lot of them were just less reliable to play. And if you didn't get any instructions, and I did use instruction manuals in games, even games like Target Renegade, where it's just, you know, keyboard controls and fire, or joystick controls and fire, you still wanted to familiarise yourself with that world, immerse yourself through the instruction manuals and the smell of it, and all that nostalgia that goes with it. That was missing, so I didn't really get into piracy at all on the Spectrum. I had pocket money then of, I think, between 50p and £2 that over the period I had a Spectrum, which meant I got to the £2 threshold. Excuse me, so that was cold and stuff full of it. It meant that I could buy a really low budget games that you could get, like, which you could get at Asda, would come at £1.99. I think I remember buying Turn-A-Knob for £1.99, and it was totally over my head. A few other games like that, Avenger maybe, a few games like that that were £1.99 that I could buy that week with that week's pocket money, which was amazing to me. That meant I could buy a game a week, and you start quantizing things like that in your head when you were a kid. Or I could save for essentially 1.5 weeks, but that really is 2 weeks, and take me £3, like me £2.99. Oh, Ghostbusters as well. I got that in Allison, I remember that from memories. £2.99 for a slightly higher budget, low budget game. Don't ask me for examples, I could probably give you some, but I don't want to go off on a tangent thinking about that. But yeah, what my memories of that are, basically that was how I bought games, the kind of £1.99, £2.99 range with my pocket money, which would, as I say, its peak was about £2, so I'd have to save for a week or so. And I loved that. That was my culture, if you like. And then there were the occasions when, I don't know, my Auntie Marie took me to a market local to where she lives in Notty Ash, so it must have been around there somewhere, and bought me Chase HQ 2, you know, a £9.99 game, which is unheard of. But of course, it was the grown-ups that you'd rely on to buy that stuff. Chase HQ 2 was rubbish, by the way, on the Spectrum. Rubbish. Especially compared with Chase HQ. Get a big pair of shoes to fill on that one, and they didn't manage it. Terrible frame rate killed it. Anyway, tangents. So this was my Spectrum memory. Not a lot of piracy going on there. That changed when I got to the Amiga, of course, and that's what I wanted to talk about. MameMeister goes on about his memories of the market, and it reminded me of something similar. I grew up in Liverpool, and went to school in Widnes, which meant I grew up in Liverpool and Widnes. The school I went to is closed now, which is a shame, because it was a good school. But basically, I had a mate who lived between it and Widnes Market. Kirby Market's another memory that we'll go into another day. Basically, I remember the Christmas I got my Amiga. It was actually 25 years ago to this Christmas just gone, so it's kind of a good time to talk about this. I got this Amiga. I got the pack I got with it was the one with Captain Planet, and I think I got Lemmings with it too. Can't remember all the games offhand. Again, if I think about it, I could get through them all individually one by one, but I'm not going to. I just wanted to talk about this. We'd go, I remember before I got the Amiga, I was late to it. It was 91. I was 13, I might be wrong there. I was 13. And a friend of mine lived by the school. He had an Amiga already for a year. Most people had already had an Amiga for at least a year by this point. Mine was a 500 plus, so I'd kind of seen the wonders of it, and they all had pirate games. Everyone was doing the pirate games in the playground at this point, and this was the first time I got initiated into that world. And he took me to Widnes Market one lunchtime when he knew I was getting it. He said, what will you do is you buy 10 blank discs and then you come to my house and we get X copy on the go and you pick, I don't know, 10 one disc games, 5 2 disc games and so on that you want. I went and I think got like 20 discs. And I went to his house and I copied a load of games off. Now, I just want to make this clear at this point. I still have very low disposable income. My mum was giving me pocket money of about £5 a week at this point. I think when I hit sort of 15, it went up to, if I remember right, £50 a month, which was incredible because, you know, we're in double figures. And it meant it changed a lot of things for me. And then when I hit 16, I think that went to £50 a week, which just blew my mind because who at 16 has that kind of disposable income? Well, I don't know, maybe everyone, I don't know. I'm sure not a lot of people. But I did. And it was great, and that changed everything. And I want to just stipulate, at that point, I started buying games. Now, don't get me wrong, it was very late in the Amiga's days. Then we're talking 95, 96, and I took up smoking. And I was going out a lot to watch bands in Liverpool, when I probably shouldn't have been, because I was like 16. But I was playing in a band, and I was you know, recording and playing live in these venues like the Lomax and Corner House and places like that in Liverpool and Widnes. So it was kind of important to me that I went to see bands, and bands were important to me. Spent a lot of money on that, but I also spent quite a lot of money on games. Actually buying big box games, you know. I remember buying the Lost Vikings. I'm not going there. But Lost Vikings was one in particular that springs to mind. I think that might have been the first one I bought. But definitely up there with one of the ones I really enjoyed. So my Amiga collection suddenly became big boxes. Over the course of a year, which of course have all gone now. I think I might have taken to a charity shop or something, as you do, and then kind of lament it because you could have got money for it, never mind. Up to that point, my collection consisted of pirated games on discs. I didn't really appreciate the legalities of it and appreciate the effect that would have on the games companies making the games, because you don't when you're 13, 14, you just want to play as many as you can. And like MameMeister said, it did actually lead to me buying the games when I had the disposable income. So, you know, like some of the developers say, it's probably a good thing in some ways that it generates sales from the general interest. But yeah, I had this thing for, as some of you know, I've been a games artist for a while. I'm currently something similar to that. Well, not actually being a games artist, but all my skills have transferred to another job at the minute. But I always like drawing and drawing art. GCSE art was my thing back then, like a lot after that. But I was always just drawing. And what I did do was I added value to my pirate games, bearing in mind how I'd seen Spectrum games on tape as kind of dirty, wrecked old things that didn't always work. I was determined to make my Amiga collection a bit more appealing to me to look at. So I had a drawer, as you do, full of Amiga games. And I can picture the desk and the drawer and the shape of it and everything. And I flicked through, and every single game at that point would have a piece of artwork that I'd lovingly drawn in felt-tip pen. Sometimes in more detail than others. Usually the games I liked more had better artwork. That was basically how it worked. And it started with the very first games I got off my friend from school. Which were basically Street Fighter 2, the first one for the Amiga, with the big sprites and the crap gameplay, the four disc one, Assassin, Wolf Child, and I've forgotten the rest, so I'll show you them instead. Now, when I was set up the retro arcade for the school, I took my Amiga to them to let them use it while we bought one in, and I took them a load of games. And I didn't want the kids to see they were pirated games because I didn't want to condone that sort of thing to them. So what I did is I took one disc games only so they didn't have to swap discs and see that they were pirated. Now, as a result, only one disc games have come home and then got into a bag and then got into the attic when the school got the GoTech on their Amiga. So that they're out of my hands. I mean, I could get them, but it's not at 6 in the morning when everyone's trying to sleep. I'm not going to go clamouring about the attic. So what I have got is in the office, I found in the drawer a load of the 2-disc games and more disc games that I didn't take to the school. Also stuff like Reality, you know, the game production engine thing that some kids bought by mail order, deluxe paints in there, stuff like that that I didn't take to the school that I've kept at home that I've been sitting in the drawer, and some without any artwork on. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to see what's in it. in this bag here. And I'll just show you a few, because let's face it, that's a big bag full of a lot of stuff. Now, let's excuse me, Seb, because I'm not just moving my iPhone about anymore. I'm moving my laptop about, and I've just realised I've got a dash cam plugged into it, because one of our little Christmas presents. It's awesome. I love my dash cam. So I thought, and then that's the alarm. telling me it's time to get up. It's 7 o'clock, but I'm already off, so that's okay. So I'm going to take a handful of these discs out, and what we'll find is sometimes you'll get stuff like this, just random scribbles. Now that's actually a disc full of artwork, deep ink stuff, beat 'em up. So there's a beat 'em up game that I did artwork for here that never got made, but I did work with a lot of codemates, more games that I made. Now I'm going to whip through these because the discs look like that, because they're all just data discs. So we'll fly through these. We've got Mike's disc 4, IV 4, yeah, I don't know what's on that, could be anything. But then we've got stuff like Amos, and this is the very basic level of me drawing on my discs. There we go. So all it is just a text with a black outline. It's nothing special there. But we still see the games that I really enjoyed. Computer science, my A-level stuff. Okay, and these are games I've borrowed. Now this is what pirated games look like borrowed off your mates. You know, about 100 games, I'm sure. It's nothing particularly to write home about. Nothing very commercial. But what I'm going to look for is... this is like obviously a set that is just not games. Okay. At the very basic level, games I wasn't really into, very, very quickly drawn on my disc, would be stuff like that. There you go. So Total Recall disc, being on the back, would be a cheat code or two. So that I, how I'd get that cheat code while the disc's in the drive, I don't know. But it is disc A. Maybe you change to disc B to put that cheat code in. Anyway, so that's like the basic, really rubbish level. But at a glance, it meant I could see the disc. But what I wanted, loads of file discs. Oh, look. Deluxe Paint 3, I actually used 4 later on, but I seem to have lost the disc. More Deluxe Paint 3. Oh wow, okay, no. There we go. Who remembers that? A Shoot 'em Up construction kit. And I used that to make Planes a Go-Go and lots of other games. We still haven't got to the pictures though. Here we go. Okay, another quick one. I literally find these as I take these as I find them. Very, very quick one. So at a glance, I can see the four-armed alien of Space Gun. That's a rubbish one. That's clearly taken me a minute or two to draw. I mustn't have thought much of Space Gun on the Amiga. I probably think more of it now than I did then. But this is cool. This is one of the first ones I got from my friend at school in that first batch that I did. So they've all got this kind of look to them and this consistency. I love this game. Shadow Warriors. Disc 1, Disc 2. How cool is that? Yeah, that's the sort of thing I was doing on most of my games discs. Let's see what else we can find in. Okay, I'm just organising these a bit because there's a big pile developing on it. This is Corporation Disc 2. I don't know if that looks like the characters in it. You never really see them in detail. I suppose you do, but... I was taking a guess there. Cyber Games, I think that was just a rubbish PD game, but I kind of liked drawing big dudes with swords. That was a kid. Agony Disc B, which is clearly meant to be, what's his name? Alistis or something, the wizard guy. It's clearly meant to be him wisping in from the side there. And I think I drew him as an owl on the other discs, but we'll have to find them. Chuck Rock, just a big logo. You'd have thought I'd have drawn Chuck, wouldn't you? On the disc B, same thing. I clearly was feeling lazy there. This is one of the better ones. In fact, I'll save this because I want to find, there's 4 discs of this game, I want to find the rest of them because I think there's like a little story in them. As in, going in a certain order. More Amos, more art. Wow, this is why these shouldn't go to school because it's just artwork. Oh, yeah, MameMeister this series 101 Ways to Die. And each disc basically contains a load of animations. Let's pause the video while I sift through these things. Right. I've sifted through the discs a bit. And I haven't found very many, which is a bit annoying. A lot of them were just art discs. I'm talking huge swathes of art discs. Stuff that I made in Duckspace. Occasional games projects that I work on with mates in school and college. I must get around to checking those out at some point. Although my Amiga is currently hooked up to a GoTech, so it's not going to happen anytime soon. But what I have got here is a big pile of multi-disc games. Not a big pile, quite a small pile. Definitely not representative of the amount that I had back then. As I say, most of them, and most of the good ones, to be honest, are in the attic. But I splashed through a few anyway. Some of these were drawn very quickly. Super Frog Disc 1, OA, Disc 2, OB, Disc 3, OC. I've clearly got some sort of story going on here. Disc D, he's landed on his little mate. And that was as much time and effort, I think, as I was willing to put into that one. We've got Deliverance, there's the big beardy dude, although I don't think he had shoulder pads. And I don't know who that guy is, but I kind of like him. I'm sure he's just a representative of the stuff you found in the background of that game. Maybe the boss at the end of it is like the devil or something, or I thought it might be, so I've drawn him in there. This is cool, this was one of the first ones I got. I don't know where Ryu got his ponytail from, but I think I drew these characters from memory, and being a Sega kid, of course, in like 91, 92, I was really not up on what the characters look like, so I think all things considered, I didn't do too bad a job. There's Chun-Li and Guile. Look at the state of his hair. Look at the state of her hair. Still, you can kind of tell they are. Darcy and Honda, I don't know what Honda's wearing on his face. Did he have face paints? I was just winging it. And Zangie from Ken. These days I could probably draw these guys from memory, but back then, me and a felt tip pen. I kind of like the logo though, that 13 year old me did. They're kind of cool. I clearly put more time into those ones. But that was one of the first games I got, so the novelty was really there. A game that I loved. Oh yeah. Now, I've clearly drawn Disc 2 on a different day, because I've used a different set of pens. That's Disc 1, that's Disc 2. Kind of cool in its way though. Remember, boys and girls, I was 13. Yeah, that's kind of good. Maybe 14. I quite like this game, actually. Cosmic Space Earth. It felt a little limited in the platforming bits, but it also, that was its charm. And there he is, having a little fly across the landscape. You'll notice some of these discs have got wet. Those codes on the back. We'll never know what they are, though, because the disc got wet. Oh, very good. Chaos Engine. Let's take the disc. It's actually literally falling apart. Let's get it recorded quick for posterity. There we go. And that was what the brigand? I don't know, I can't remember. I like his stubble. Yeah, these are good. These were some of my first ones that I got copied, as I said. I like that. A lot of time and love's gone to that. Wolf Child, this guy. Look at that picture, that wolf. Looking a bit goofy. Yeah, put a bit of time on. And there's Saul himself, gritting his teeth and looking angry. So my disc drawer basically consisted of this stuff. What does that say, game? After level 1, it's not all walking. There's a level skip apparently. I've written level codes all over it, which is kind of cool, helpful. Another great platformer, a bit later on I think. And you can see I've done this one quite quickly. There's Joe of Yojo fame, and there's this mate, I can't remember his name, was it Kip or something? With the hat on, I can't remember his name, he wasn't Kip, or something like that. Apparently there's an exclamation mark after both words. Here's an interesting one. Now those of you who had eSWAT might remember, so I've got the other video of me playing in the background here, and it's really putting me off. And it won't stop, I've just got to leave it. Might remember eSWAT on the Amiga. It wasn't a great conversion, and to be honest, the arcade wasn't that good. I've got a version of it upstairs now, and it's quite close to the Amiga version. It felt a little bit loose to play, but one thing it did have on the Amiga was no protection of the artwork. You could literally just get at the artwork in deluxe paint, and I did. And I was, when I was a kid, I had like long curly hair, I looked like Slash. But I did a version of eSWAT with me in it, and I called it imaginatively titled Mike Swat. And there I am, with blood in the background. There's a code there, just where it is to move me for lives around it. But yeah, that's kind of cool. That was me, as I pictured myself at 13, with massive shoulders and curly hair. But it's disc 2 that I like, because I didn't really change the robot version. I was just lazy. I should have done. Should have got in there and really messed with the graphics. But check that dude out. He's kind of scary, isn't he? Give RoboCop a run for his money. I like that. I've even like done the shine on the gun and everything. Look at that. Must have been 14 by the time I did that one. Bit of time into that one. Shadow of the Beast just got its logo. There's a few like that that I haven't included because it was just a logo. Let's see if we get on this too. Nothing to see there. Which is a shame because Shadow of the Beast could have had some nice artwork. I was clearly feeling lazy that day. And this day too, Lotus 2 just got a little weird desert landscape. I think that was because I couldn't draw cars to save my life back then. I've since improved, but I'm not really into cars enough to really care. Cool spot. It's got itself wet and the colours have run a bit, but there he is. Disc B, I think this one tells a story. It does tell a story, there he is with his thumbs up. And the big boots come down and crush them. Don't know what possessed me. Clearly just a bit of whimsy and doodling going on. Good gamer. Cool spot, especially the Amiga version. Yeah, another one that's got wet, bullet and sticks, awesome game. Really hard though, and I think it gets less fun a bit further in. But that, yeah, clearly the colours have just run to hell there. And there's the baddie, can't remember his name, but there's my attempt at the baddie from memory. And the colours are run a bit too. That's just a bit of paper I've glued over the top, it's not even a label. Nitro, not much to see there. Again, my ineptitude of drawing cars back then has resulted in just a nice little landscape. Although this Nitro Disc B, I do, if you look at the top, I do attempt to draw some car silhouettes really badly. Weird dust cloud. Don't get me wrong, they were 5-minute sketches, you know, it wasn't like I was going all out here. Putty, and I was 13 people. Putty. And Putty Disc 2, clearly representing the mood I was in when I drew it, having a yawn. It's not the most interesting thing to draw, to be honest, on a disc. This is cool, this was more my cup of tea. The game was arguably a bit rubbish, but I loved all the colourful characters, so I got them in there. Apparently that's Buzz, Ty and Kato of Pit Fighter thing. Stayed of them. It's kind of cool though, isn't it? All the shine on them. Clearly found a flesh coloured felt tip pen, and wow, I've actually got pretty much all the baddies in properly, I think, on this too. Look at that, that's fun, isn't it? Look at that pit fire, this too. Rubbish game. Well, no, it was, well, it was, yeah, it just was. One you saw earlier, Shadow Warriors, disc 1 and 2, somehow they got in there, but I like it so much I felt like showing it again. And Chuck Rocky. These aren't going to last long in my hands, are they? You've seen Chuck Rock this one too. You saw Agony Disc 1 as well. Now, somewhere here, there's Disc 8 or Disc 2. You've seen that. Somewhere here, I found another one. I think it's Disc C, but it's got lost in the pile. So we'll come across that when we do. And also, I showed you before Cyber Games Disc A. Well, apparently there was a Cyber Games Disc B in which I've slit a cyber guy's throat. Classy. Stay classy, mate. Stay classy. Corporation, we've seen. Total Recall, we've seen. Let's pop those out the way. Now, this was the one I wanted to hold back to show you because it's got a story and it's Lionheart. Now, there's disc one. And, you know, he doesn't undergo a transformation in the game. He undergoes a transformation in the front end of the game, in the intro, in the animation. Or does he? We don't really know. His face is all liony, but in the game he's just a guy. I just want to establish that. So in my head there was some transformation going on, and this was drawn before I properly played it. I knew how good it was, but I hadn't properly played it. So there's this one. He's a dude. Oh, cheats on the back. There he is. Look at all the ink I must have used on that. It gets worse. Disc 2. He starts to mutate. Can you guess what he's going to turn into? disc 3. He's definitely mutated now. And disc 4. It's a lot of black ink. Full on growly lion. Rawr. Your guess is as good as mine as to what was going through my teenage, young teenage mind at the time. You've seen Space Gun Disc 2, but there was a Space Gun Disc 1, which kind of makes it make more sense. There's the guy shooting at the alien. Have I got this the right way around? No, of course I haven't. There we go. That is the story. Right there. Hey? Hey? See? That's just a pretty face. And little story there in disc format. I'm missing a Woody's World disc, but there he is. There's Woody. And by disc C, he's turned himself into a frog. Yeah, little story. His body blows ones are terrible. Well, the first one's alright, but you can see I lost interest very quickly. I can't remember the characters. Is that Doug, the fat guy there, the wrestler? And Nick, maybe, or Dan? I don't know, I can't remember. And then we've got Ninja, imaginatively named, and the boxer dude whose name I can't remember. But you can see these get worse and worse as the discs go on. And then there's another two characters there. And then by the last one, I mean, I really can't be bothered by them. Which is weird, because usually I go for the colourful stuff and with the big characters. What I should have done is not done them standing against each other. I should have done like the Street Fighter mode, where you've got like an upper body shot, and then I'd have gone into detail, and then I'd have probably kept interest. Oh, look. Agony Disc guy. There he is. So, there's a story there, too, clearly. Let's see if I can find that other Agony one. Chug Rock. Where are you, Agony? Technical. I've lost it. But... oh, there it is. Excellent. So, the reason is wispy. So there is the wizard guy, Anastasia. Whatever his name was, began with an A. It's kind of cool. I like his little hat brim. Shoulder pads. And there he is, wisping. Can you guess what comes next? He transforms into a really badly drawn owl. Oh dear, look at that state of that. But there you go. A little story for you. This became like a trend, I think. Oh, cool. Another world. There's the dude with the orange hair. Can't remember his name. Awesome, awesome game, awesome game. Just doesn't need any instruction. And there's the blue dude. Clearly drawn very quickly, but pretty recognisable. Now, I think I lost the disc or two of this. Oh no, apparently not. Apparently I got them all. This was quite easy for me. Fury of the Fairies just got yellow fairy. Red fairy, you will notice that they've all got their own little expressions. Oh no, no. Yeah, there's green fairy. He's quite sleepy, man. He looks a little sleepy fairy. And blue fairy, who's just nuts about it. I don't know if that's the case in the game. I think I just drew them with different eyes to differentiate them. And then disc E, five discs. There, I've got them all off doing their little skills. So clearly I was familiar with the game when I was drawing that, because I knew the skills. Red has got teeth, yellow's got fire, green has got rope, and blue. I don't know. Drawn very quickly, yeah. Clearly couldn't really be bothered. There's another Woody's World one. He's waving his wand. I think then it goes to the frog. He waves his wand and turns himself into a frog. I'm not going to show you them all again. You can rewind it if you really care about the story. Full contact. I think I've taken that concept from the silhouettes on the intro, you know, doing all the Tai Chi stuff. You know what I mean? Now, these are both X-209 type games, both PD games, I think. Pseudo-cop, quite like the X-209 on that. There's something charming about that. It's like he's grinning. And X-209 The Revenge. I don't think either of them were particularly good games, but they were kind of PD demos, if I remember right. Well, I quite like being I clearly enjoyed myself doing that. Probably more than I did playing the game. Colorado. This looks like it's been written over a game. Who knows what the history of these things are now. Double Dragon 3, with a really weird version of apparently Billy's face that doesn't really... he's not really recognisable as Billy with that spiky hair, is he? Then again, in Double Dragon 3, who is recognisable as themselves? They really lost the style at that point. And there's Disc 2, which has clearly got Jimmy on it. But if I remember rightly, those two sprites are pretty much the same. In fact, is there even two-player mode in it? I'm not sure. It was a decent game on the Amiga. That was probably the best version. Better than the arcade, for sure. Spectrum version was alright, actually, as well. But it was a little bit static. And it, as I say, it lost the style. The Double Dragon franchise. Barbarian 2. We need a flesh tone felt tip. Some pretty bad shades. And Barbarian 2 chick. Using the same colours, though, there's like a consistency across them. I like that. Xenon 2, when I didn't have any appreciation for the shape of the spaceship. I still don't really like that game as much as most people do. It feels a bit cheap, but graphics are nice. The spaceship looks nothing like that, by the way. It's more triangular. I know it shoots quite well these days, being more of a retro gamer. And then finally, a bit of anti-climax. Shadow Fighter, where I couldn't even be bothered drawing the fighters. It's just text on a disc, but in bright colours. Shouldn't have even included that one. But yeah, so there's a tip of the iceberg, and it did lead to me buying games. I just wanted to share those with you, because I thought they're quite interesting to look at, and who doesn't get a bit of nostalgia from a floppy disk, eh? And before they go up in the attic with all the other one disc games, which I may dig out if anyone wants to see them, I thought I'd just let you have a look. Right, that was a really long video, so I'm going to stop it there. But yeah, there we go. Some of my pirate gaming memories. Thanks for watching.